question is, can you win? I came to tell somebody up in here tonight that there is something on the inside of you that's going to help you win in this season, and it's called a champion. You ought to open up your mouth and shout, I am a champion. Everything attached to you wins. I said everything attached to you wins. Can you point to your neighbor and tell them, everything attached to you wins. Come on, let's tell them. Everything attached to you wins. Now just tell them, say, it's your winning season.
It's your winning
season. You've got God to carry you. You've got God to carry you. That's what He's going to do tonight. Because you can't afford to lose again. You can't afford to lose again. Oh, it's your winning season. Last time, say, this is what I need you to do, because I realize that you can't say you are a winner but look defeated. I need you to get up out of your seat and high five 10 people across this room. Don't just stay at your room. Tell them across the room that you will win. Come on, high five 10 people and tell them you will win. You will win. God don't birth failures. God don't call you defeated. You are.
You shouldn't judge a book by its cover. Call me lucky. Only still alive cause he's so good. Yeah, he turned my morning into dancing. I'm laughing, telling everybody that he's so.
If you only knew where I started from, you would understand my praise.
You would understand my praise.
Catching up on all the things he's done. Yeah, we got it out the mud.
We came from nothing.
Only made it cause we cut.
Put respect on his name.
I'm only here because he made a way.
All right, y'all, it's my turn. Yeah, he reached down when I'm
living
low. Then he carried the weight when I
wasn't strong.
Yeah, told me I'm yours when I
been below.
All I'm really trying to say is
he's good.
Yeah.
Brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me?
cover me.
You cover me.
I appreciate it.
A mystery.
It's amazing how
your patience with me, God will never leave.
You don't give up on me.
Don't ever leave.
Help me.
Help me to see like you.
Like you.
No matter what I go through,
hey.
Everything's working for my good for a way.
Let me tell you what he does.
He saves the day.
And he will.
He will come through.
Hallelujah.
Against your character, you will win, win, you will win, win. The enemy came up against your health, the enemy came up against your finances, the enemy came up against your vision. Came up against your business.
Anyone who loves life,
you will win.
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 Oh, you will win.
You will win.
Yes, you will. Yes,
you will.
I know you're torn. I know you're broken, but
win. I came to tell somebody up in here tonight that there is something on the inside of you that's going to help you win in this season, and it's called a champion. You ought to open up your mouth and shout, I am a champion. Everything attached to you wins. I said everything attached to you wins. Can you point to your neighbor and tell them, everything attached to you wins. Come on, let's say, tell me, everything attached to you wins. Just tell them, say, it's your winning season.
It's your winning season.
You've got God to carry you.
It's your
You've got God to carry you.
It's your
That's what he's going to do tonight.
It's your
Cause you can't afford to lose again.
It's your
you can't afford to lose again.
It's your
oh, it's your winning season.
It's your
Last time, say, everything. Attached to me wins. This is what I need you to do. Because I realize.
Good morning and welcome to the Christian House of Prayer Ministries, where we are one house. We pray that you will experience the light, life, and love of God during today's service. We invite you to join us at any and all of our services. Now, let's get ready to worship.
Good morning. Let us all stand and bow our heads. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We just thank you, Heavenly Father, for this day, God. We thank you for who you are. We thank you, Father, for being Jehovah Ra. You are our shepherd. You are our good shepherd, our chief shepherd, and our great shepherd. Father, we thank you for being Elohim, the God of creation. Father, we thank you that we know that you own the cattle upon the thousand hill, and the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, Father. We just thank you, Father, for how you gave us your son, Jesus Christ, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. Father, we thank you, God, for how that, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, Father. Father, we thank you, God, for hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just know that you are Lord. You are our God. Father, as we worship you today, God, on Palm Sunday, Father, we thank you, Father, for how that Jesus Christ came in triumphantly, Father, and the Father that the people put down palms, Father, worshiping him, God. For, Father, he knew, God, that what he would have to do, he would have to go to the cross, Father, to die for our sins, Father, and raise up again, Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, Father, for the angel of this church, and Pastor Valerie Ivory Hogan, Father. We thank you, God, for how her name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, God. We thank you, Father, for her continued strength. We thank you, Father, for how that she studied to show herself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, God. We thank you, Father, for how she feeds her lambs and feeds her sheep, Father. We thank you, God, that it is her job to teach us the word, God, and it's our job to receive that word, Father, and to act on that word, God. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, for her family, Father, for how that you have blessed them, Father, exceedingly, abundantly, and above all that they can even imagine or even think of, God. We just thank you, Father, for the eldership, the deaconship, and the membership of this house, Father. Father, we thank you for souls, God. This is our main job, Father, is to win souls for Christ, Father. God, we just thank you, Father, for the backsliders. We thank you, Father, how that they will return back into Zion this day, God. Father, we ask you and we pray, Father, that you will wrap them up, tie them up, and tangle them up in the word, Father, in your love, Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the speaker today, God. We know that the word will come, faith will come, and then here comes the devil, Father. But your word says, God, that to submit ourselves unto God, and that, Father, that the word will just concrete us, make us concrete in your word, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Holy Spirit, how that you will orchestrate this service today, God, from the parking lot to the pulpit, Father. Have your way in this service. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And let us all say, amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Those hands together as we celebrate Jesus Christ triumphing yet. Hallelujah. I wish I could tell you, I wish I could describe it, but I can't contain it, can't keep it to myself. There aren't enough colors to paint the whole picture, not enough words to ever say what I found. Wonderful and beautiful and glorious and holy, He is merciful and powerful.
Who we talking about? That's my King. We give Him the glory, give Him all the honor. All together worthy. Who we talking about? That's my King. There's the one before you. Yes, we will adore you.
Who we talking about? That's
you, we adore you, we lift our hands, we worship our Jesus. Yes, Father, we thank you. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We give you glory, God. You deserve it, God. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start right now. Why would we wait? King of glory, fill this place. Just want to be with you. That's our heart's cry, God. We just want to be with you. Come on and lift it up to Him.
Personal. King. just wanna be with you. Come on and say it again. King of glory, fill this place. We just wanna be with you. We just wanna be with you. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. We bless your name, Jesus. Come on and give him praise.
Just
come on and listen,
Jesus. Close to you.
Yes, God.
Just to be close to you. Just to be close to you is my desire. Just to be close to you. Just to be close. Just to be close to you is my desire. Help me say, just to be close to you. Just to be close to you. Ooh, just to be close to you is my desire. Just to be close to you. Just to be close to you is my desire. Close, close. Close, close. Ooh, close, close is my desire. Is my desire. Oh, close, close. Down at the feet, oh God, close.
Close.
It is the most high place. Close,
close.
Is my desire. Is my desire. Just to be close. Just to be close to you. Just to be close to you. Just to be close to you is my desire. One more time. Just to be close to you.
Just to be close.
Just to be close to you.
No other place I'd rather be.
Just to be close to you
is my desire.
Come on and worship him in the beauty of holiness. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Do you desire to be close to him? Hallelujah. Guess what? He desires to be close to you too. Come on, give the Lord a mighty hand of praise. Hallelujah. But while you're standing on your feet, you know that you desire to be close to him because he desires to be close to you. Then we're going to decree what the Lord has already, or we're going to declare what the Lord has already decreed. In Psalm 91, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder. The young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good morning, Christian House of Prayer. Good morning to the Palm Sunday crowd, too. So good, say, let me see how we can say that. Good Palm Sunday morning. Amen. You may have your seats in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, it's time, that time again, that we come before you to welcome our first-time visitors and all of those who are joining us by way of social media and our CCI family. We want you to know that, especially those who are joining in by way of social media, we want you to like us, to share us, and to subscribe to us. We're so glad, and on behalf of Pastor Valerie Holcomb, we want you to know that you are welcome to any and all of our services. And if you'll check us out on our app, you'll see everything that's going on in the Christian House of Prayer. Come on, y'all, let's give our social media and CCI family a round of applause. Now, for those that we've been praying that you would come into the sanctuary, and that's the people that are here for the very first time. This is your very first time joining us here at the Christian House of Prayer. We promise that we will not embarrass you in any way. We won't put the microphone in your face. We won't ask you to say anything, but we will ask you to do something. If you're here for the very first time, would you please stand so that we can see who you are? Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Now, before you have your seats, the ushers have something that they want to give to you. And in that, you'll find a name badge. We want you to put that name badge. Welcome. We want you to take that out, put that name badge on your lapel, on the top part of your garment. Write your name, whatever it is that you want to be called, because we want to lavish you with the love of the Lord. Amen? So, okay, and then also in that envelope, you'll find a card, and you'll find it has a QR code on it. And at the end of the service, or probably this afternoon, I would suggest that you can scan that code, that QR code, and there's a complimentary copy of a message from our beloved pastor, Pastor Valerie Holcomb, that she wants you to have, just because we're so happy that you came to be with us today. Christian House of Prayer, let's give our first-time visitors another hand. Now, we've been having some people who've come back. Maybe you've been gone because you've been TDY or PCS, and now you're back in this area, or for whatever reason, you may have been gone, but you are a member of the Christian House of Prayer, and you're returning today. Would you please stand? Hallelujah. Elder Chisholm, it is so good to see you back in the house. Hallelujah. Oh, and Tiffany has the new baby. Pastor Tiffany got the new baby. Oh, that's a she? He's a first-time visitor. Welcome. We're so glad to have y'all back. That's a blessing. And then we know we've received notices all during the week of others of our family members who have had loved ones to go on. They've passed. We want you to know, on behalf of Pastor, that our hearts are with you. We love you and we pray for you. You may not know it all the time, but I hope you can even sense it. Even when it's a hard time in your life, that you know that you have family members who are praying with you and for you. Amen? And so we want you to know that we trust the Lord, that you're comforted by His Spirit most of all, but by the saints and by the Word of God. Amen? At this time, I want you to pay attention to the Jumbotron for all further announcements, and I will be back in a little bit. God bless.
The Christian House of Prayer is encouraging all of our members this Resurrection Sunday to invite someone to church. Resurrection Sunday will be next Sunday, March 31st, so let's take this time out and plan to invite someone to church on Sunday, March 31st, during our 10 a.m. service. The Christian House of Prayer's Total Solar Eclipse Watch Party is just around the corner. This special event will be held on April 8th in the Killeen and Coppers Cove parking lot locations. There will be food and drinks provided. This Total Solar Eclipse event will not come around again until 2044. So if you're interested in being a part of this very rare event, register online at CHOP.org and the CHOP app. The Christian House of Prayer's Hymn Books in the Foyer has reopened and is available to serve you. Take advantage of our ongoing sale on previous year's mantra note takers, available in binders and spirals. You may also purchase selected CDs on sale right now, so stop by and see us. We also have the new 2024 mantra spirals available for purchase. Stop by and visit us before or after service at Hymn Books in the Foyer. Coming in April to the Christian House of Prayer, it's a special class dealing with the manifestation and healing power of God and the subject of abortion. Join Sister Deborah Morrell on Saturday, April 6th at 10 a.m. in the lecture hall for The Secrets in Your Past, a testimony of post-abortive healing and redemption. This class is open to anyone who is struggling with secrets from their past and is longing to walk in God's freedom and peace from shame, torment, and condemnation. Join us on Saturday, April 6th at 10 a.m. for this special class, Secrets in Your Past, a testimony of post-abortive healing and redemption with Sister Deborah Morrell in the lecture hall. Covenant Savings Federal Credit Union has great news for all of our members. We've gone digital. For your convenience, you can take care of all of your banking needs through our website or on our new mobile app. To get started, log on to Covenant Savings website at mycsfcu.org and click on the Digital Banking tab at the top right. Enroll by clicking on New to Digital Banking and register your account. It's that simple. By utilizing the digital banking features on the web or on the app, you now have the ability to view your account transactions, make loan payments, check balances on all of your accounts, perform internal and external transfers, order checks, set up reoccurring internal transfers, and so much more. You may also choose to go paperless and receive your statements online. So log on today at mycsfcu.org or download our app by searching for Covenant Savings FCU in Google Play or on the App Store. The Prayer Practitioner and Healing Clinic will be meeting on Thursday, April 4th from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. in the lecture hall. Prayer Practitioner and Healing Clinic is a time designed to inspire and develop God's people in the area of prayer and the authority of God's Word concerning healing. Join us as we go deeper in prayer and learn more about what God's Word says about our healing. That's the Prayer Practitioner and Healing Clinic on Thursday, April 4th from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. in the lecture hall. For more information, contact Elder Sandra Hilliard at 254-661-5855. Celebrating 50 years of marriage, last Sunday, March 17th, is Robert and Carolyn Duncan. Also celebrating 35 years of marriage tomorrow, March 25th, is Carl and Phyllis Pitts. The Christian House of Prayer family wishes these couples a happy anniversary and many more to come. The Christian House of Prayer's 43rd anniversary is right around the corner, and because we're operating in the spirit of unity as one house, we'll be wearing special colors each Sunday. For those members that would like to take part, on Sunday, April 7th, we'll be wearing something red. On Sunday, April 14th, we'll be wearing something purple. On Sunday, April 21st, we'll be wearing something green. And on Sunday, April 28th, we'll be wearing something white. Make a note of these colors and let's get involved as we get ready to celebrate our 43rd church anniversary, beginning on Sunday, April 7th at 10 a.m. The Christian House of Prayer is seeking individuals with handyman skills. If you're interested and would like to be considered, please contact Elder Joe Walker at 254-394-1937 during business hours. Thank you.
Now, y'all do know that when on the day of that eclipse, you got to have some special glasses, right? Okay, make sure you got your special glasses on, because otherwise that sun, it can hurt your eyes. All right, what time is it? All right, amen. Come on, let's get excited. Let's get real excited. You know, in this house, we've been taught, and I saw that about the power of unity. You remember Pastor teaching us about the power of unity? And she had some points. She said, unity is a reflection of God's nature. Unity with diversity is God's design. Y'all know them? Unity with mutual respect and care is God's intention. And unity in how we think is God's harmony. Then the fifth one was unity in how we talk is God's command. And today is Palm Sunday. And so as I was studying, and I think it was like Monday, this came to me. Unity in how we give displays God's generosity. Did you hear that? Unity in how we give displays God's generosity. And so as we are celebrating all over the world in Christendom, Palm Sunday today, we are reminded, and Deacon Bass reminded us as he prayed, about Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And we celebrate it like it's a week before his triumphant resurrection from the dead. Hallelujah. He was raised up with all power in his hands. And you know, in every one of the Gospels, it's recorded. But I love Luke's recording. In the 19th chapter of Luke, starting at about the 28th, I believe it is, verse, it talks about how Jesus was near Bethany and Bethphage. And he sent two disciples. He said, go to the village that's right ahead. And when you get there, you're going to find a donkey, a colt. That means a baby donkey, in which no man has ever sat. And I want you to get him for me. And he says to them, if anybody asks you, what are you doing when you're loosing him? Tell him the Lord hath need of him. Now in the Gospel according to Luke, in about the 33rd verse, I love it because it says, and the owners, it had an S on it. The owners asked, what are you doing? And they said, the Lord hath need of him. You know what I found interesting is that the owners didn't quibble or quarrel. You know, usually if you have two or three owners of something, one may agree. One may say, yes, we're going to do it. The other one says, no. But the Bible doesn't indicate any of that. And I want you to know, when I went to see the 7th and 8th episodes of The Chosen, the 4th season, the man asked him that, and he just started rejoicing, hallelujah, when they said, the Lord hath need of it. And he just let him go. That was generosity because, you know, a new coat was a symbol of wealth and prosperity. And think about it, nobody had ever ridden up on it. You know, new horses and new coats, what do they do if you go to the rodeo? They buck and carry on, but this one didn't, because he was going to carry the master. Hallelujah. And so today, the Lord has need of us. And we're going to display our generosity in giving. Hallelujah. Through our tithe, our offering, and our gifts of love. because he so generously gave his life. Because I'm reminded how the story says that when he got on the colt and he started going that way, hallelujah, they laid the palm branches and even their cloaks on the road for him. But I'm reminded of what Elder Ty often says, but Jesus was cross-eyed. He was cross-eyed for you, and he was cross-eyed for me. Come on, y'all, stand to your feet. Hallelujah. Hold your tithe and your offering in your right hand. Don't forget the refuge, offering for the refuge this morning. We're going to pray. Father, this wonderful, glorious Sunday morning that we celebrate Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, knowing what was going to go on. He, that prophet of God, that man of God, that son of God, and that son of man, knowing what he was going to do. He was headed to the cross to save us. And Lord, just as they laid their palm branches and cloaks on the ground and hollered, Hosanna, Hosanna, glory to God in the highest. Today we lift our tithes, our offerings, and our gifts of love unto you. And Lord, we want you to be so pleased with our unity of giving this morning, that you pour back into each and every one of your people's lives. And you already have, because you've been so generous. You let us see another day. Lord, you gave us something to be able to give. And for that, we say thank you. Lord, receive this, our tithes and offerings. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on, let's give. Hallelujah. Let's do our confession of faith. People are standing in line to get into this church to hear the word of God. Every seat is filled in every service with expectations of signs, wonders, and miracles. Our Sunday morning service at 10 o'clock in Killeen and any other service that we might have. Every need in this ministry is met, and we are 100% tithe givers. All of our property is paid off in full, and we owe nothing to no man but to love. Every member of this church is healed, healthy, blessed, and prosperous, and we are reaching the world with the gospel through our prayers and support. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the doors of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. And being fully persuaded that what he hath promised, he was able also to perform. Christ encourages you, and his love comforts you. God's spirit unites you, and you are concerned for others. Now make me completely happy. Live in harmony by showing love for each other. Be united in what you think as if you were only one person. It's God's urgency of now. We are one house. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. Enjoy your Palm Sunday. Now, for the most, I think for me, it's the most inspirational choir in all of Central Texas, Rhema.
Hallelujah. How many know that the blood still works? The blood still works. No matter what, the blood still works. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, Yes, it does. delivered you. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 In a service like this, it leaves you speechless where all you can say is hallelujah. I know you've come packing your hallelujah because you got those every Sunday. But can I find out who came packing a Hosanna? Oh, hallelujah. I want to hear Hosanna on the highest. We're celebrating Palm Sunday, are we not? Let God hear your Hosanna.
Hosanna.
The word Hosanna, Zanna means Lord, save now. Hosanna. That's what they cried out on Palm Sunday when the Lord entered into Jerusalem on a donkey of all things. He rode on a donkey to show his humility. But although he showed us his humility, we want to remind ourselves that he's our master. And because he's our master, he deserves our Hosanna. Lord, save now. They reminded us that the blood still works. See, those of you who are standing on your feet, you fully understand and comprehend. You can honestly appreciate the blood still works because he has been a bridge over troubled waters. He's been a lily in the valley. There's so many things we can say about our God, but listen, the blood still works. The blood, it brings life. And we're here this morning because we need a blood transfusion. The blood still works. But then the blood also gives unto us a true conversion. I heard someone say years ago that if the devil wanted to get to you, he got to go through the blood. And here's the power about the blood. That when the devil goes through the blood, by the time he gets his hand on you, he got to call you brother and sister. I'm talking about the blood so strong, it'll turn the devil good. You may have your seats in the presence of our life-changing King. The blood still works. As we honor our Lord and Savior this morning on Palm Sunday, I have a word for you, but before I do, let's honor the angel the messenger of this house in that of Pastor Valerie Holcomb. We thank God for his appointed, divinely anointed servant who stands in our midst, who gives us the word of God. And like today, she commissions others who she would trust to bring the word. And Pastor Valerie, I thank you for honoring me. I'm humbled by the opportunity to bring the word, not just before the body of Christ, but also before you as our pastor. Thank you, woman of God. I want to say to CCI and to our family abroad, those who tune in every week, and maybe you just turned on Christian House of Prayer this morning, thank you for joining us this morning. We trust that God has a word for you, so hold on to your seats, amen. We thank God for you all. Christian House of Prayer, I'm about to go straight into the word, but I want to thank God for each and every last one of you, my brothers and sisters in Christ, my comrade in arms. We're in the trenches together. None of us can do what all of us can do because we're better together. Amen. Thank you all. If you would, stand to your feet. I want to get right into the reason that we've come here. Thank God for the prayer that we received this morning and everyone that's serving in some capacity in the house of God. Your work does not go unnoticed. God says in Hebrews chapter 6 that he will reward your labor of love, that he is not unworthy to forget what you have done and how you minister to the saints. And so for everything that has been done up until this point, and even myself as I surrender to the Holy Spirit to give the word, we just want to say thank you. It's been done all for the glory of God and in the name of his Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I want us to go to Matthew 28. And for your hearing, I'm going to read what's recorded in Matthew 28, verse 1 through 8 in the NIV version. 'Once you're there, you can say, I'm there. If you're not there, say, I'm getting there. Amen. Well, we're going to wait for those who are getting there. Amen. Matthew's is found pretty much in the center of your Bible if you don't want to go to your table of contents. It's the first book of the four Gospels. If you are at Matthew, say, I'm there. If you're still trying to get there, say, I need my neighbor to help me out. Just go ahead and ask your neighbor, or look on your neighbor's Bible, amen? Time is of the essence. Matthew 28, verse 1 through 8, the NIV, New International Version. If you have another translation, you can still read your translation. It's going to say the same thing, just slightly different, but it has the same meaning, amen? Or you can look up on the monitors. This is what it reads. After the Sabbath. The Sabbath is Saturday, if you didn't know that. That's the day of rest. It's the end of the week. And so the scriptures tells us that after the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, that's today, Sunday. Many people consider Monday the first day of the week, but it's Sunday. It's the Lord's day. And what happened on the first day of the week? Well, we find two women, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. What did the angel do? That's what y'all waiting to do, right? Y'all waiting to sit on it. I'm gonna get you there. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said." The Lord don't lie to us. "Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples." What are we to tell folk? "He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Look at somebody and say, "It's all about him." Our Lord Jesus Christ. You may have your seats. You want to do now what the angel did? Sit on it. Maybe one day Pastor Valerie will allow me to bring a message just entitled, "Sit on it." That's talking about rest. But that's not the title for today. It's not the thought for today. What we're going to discuss on this morning, our title is Love Illustrated. Because that's what this was all about. It's Love Illustrated. And the subtitle, The Passage of Passion. The Passage of Passion. Now, this text that I just read from, it's typically used for next Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. But it's so apropos for what we're going to talk about on this morning, because today it starts what's considered the Passion Week, and some call it Holy Week. Today, Palm Sunday, it began a parade that Jesus put on himself. And he visited several locations. And during this week, Jesus was lining up with Scripture. There were prophecies of the Messiah to come. And Jesus spent this entire week, the Passion Week, lining up with the prophecies, proving that he was the Messiah. Now, many years ago, because I'm going to set you up for what we're going to do this morning, many years ago, as a church, many of us gathered and flew to Israel, the Holy Land. And while in Israel, we received a tour guide. And the tour guide's name, Andrea, was Meir. You remember that? His name was Meir. Remember that, Pastor Val? And Meir took his time. He was an Israel Hebrew tour guide. He took his time and took us to so many places in Israel. What we saw was so vast, we couldn't stay in one hotel. We literally had to stay in four different hotels because we covered the span of so much areas. But what Meir did was he made the tour very interesting in that he shared some things that was humorous. Like, I remember an account he took us to the Western, or they call it the Wailing Wall. Y'all have heard of the Wailing Wall. And when we got to the Wailing Wall, we were so appreciative. And at the Wailing Wall, you would not only pray, but many people would write out their prayers and fold it up in a small paper and stick the papers inside the concrete of the wall. And it's literally thousands, maybe millions of papers for centuries stuck into this wall, in the grooves and the cracks and the crevices of the wall. And you would just pray on this wall. And after that experience, we get on the bus to leave the Wailing Wall, and Meir said, We don't call this the Wailing Wall anymore. He says it's known as the Western Wall. He said because it was the Wailing Wall when we lost our land. He says, and so we wailed and we wept and we cried out to God. He says, but God has restored our land. He says, so it's no longer called the Wailing Wall. He says, however, in the United States, you all still have a Wailing Wall. And I was perplexed. I said, I didn't know that. My ear is a good tour, God. He wasn't just telling me about Israel. Now he was telling me about the United States, Elder Hilliard. And he says, you all have a Wailing Wall in the United States. And I said, my ear, I didn't know. I said, where is our Wailing Wall? He says, you all call it the IRS building. I said, Mayer, you absolutely right, man. Once a year, we got a pilgrimage where we just wail unto God. They want those taxes, man. And so Mayer, as a guide, he was a good guide because he would take time out and give us some humor. But then also, there was moments, plenty of moments, where he was sober. And I recall one of the moments being at Via Dolorosa. And he walked us through Via Dolorosa. Remember that, Elder Gary? And as he walked us through Via Dolorosa, the town, it was so busy and robust with business. And people were selling items and articles and making noise and merry. And I said to Andrea, as we walked close to my ear, I said, Andrea, it's sad to me how they just messed up this area. And Maya overheard me saying to Andrew how they messed up the area, and he asked, he says, why do you say they messed up Via Dolorosa? I said, because they should have kept it sacred. They should have kept it where they didn't have all this business going on and all these people in traffic. And Maya said, oh, no. He says, quite the contrary. He says, it was just like this and even the more. He says, the reason why they took Jesus this way is because back then they didn't have CNN. And they wanted as many people as they could to see him carry that cross, to see him with that shame and that burden so that they can spread the word. And all of a sudden, my heart dropped because I said, my God, the mockery, the shame that they put on our Lord, and they paraded him through Via Dolorosa. I say that because this morning, I'm your Maya. I'm going to be your tour guide. I'm going to show you love illustrated by God. But I'm going to take you through this passage of his passion. Now, we won't look at everything. We don't have time to do that. But there will be certain landmarks that I'm going to point out to you. And I want you to consider these landmarks throughout the week and take time out to study them. The first landmark that we ought to consider is a place called Gethsemane. Gethsemane symbolically represents our lows. The vicissitudes of life gives us ebbs and flows, ups and downs. Now, we all love the mountaintop experiences. We all love it when our money is right. We all love it when our bills are paid. We all love it when our children are acting accordingly. We all love it when our health is in pristine condition. We love the highs. However, there comes a season where you got to go through the lows. And Jesus could have went anywhere he wanted, but he made sure he stopped at a place called Gethsemane. Because he wanted us to understand that if he can go through the lows, so can we. Gethsemane, it means wine press. It's the place of pressure. Jesus went to the wine press, to the Gethsemane, because he wanted to show us that there will be times of pressure, but in the pressure, how we can have powerful prayer. If you want bread, they got to first beat the wheat. You can't have wine if they don't first crush the grapes. And what I'm saying to you is that when you're at your very best, it's as a result of the press. You can't get to your best without the press. And oftentimes we get frustrated, uptight, and not right because we're going through the lows. But understand this, as a child of God, your steps are ordered by the Lord. But here's the problem. When we think of steps, we want to go up. But sometimes the Lord's steps will take you down. What do you do when his steps go down? How do you respond when he orders you to Gethsemane, to press? I grew up in Philadelphia on the East Coast, and we have multiple ways to travel. You can travel by buses, cabs, but my favorite way to travel, a lot of people didn't like this way, but it was called the subway. A lot of folks don't like the subway. It's dangerous in the subway. Now, for those who's, you know, from here or maybe other parts of the world, you don't know what the subway is, I'm not talking about the sandwich shop. I'm talking about a train that runs where? Underground. I'm talking about going down. The subway is dirty, Robert. The subway can be dangerous, Terry. What the subway does, Prince, is it hides you. It's dark in the subway. But you can get where you need to get to fast. You get there quicker than if you was on the bus. The bus got to stop at every corner. I can't stand taking a bus. And here's the point. Many of you, you got goals. Many of you were promised to be at a particular place in your life, and you're upset with God because of all the stops. But the reason for all the stops, Kim, they don't want to take the subway. They want to be up on the bus. Look at my brother. They want to be up on the bus. They want the scenic route. But if you are willing to get down, to get dirty, to go dark, and sometimes even see some danger, you're going to have to take that subway. Somebody say, take the subway. See, the way of God is the subway. Now, I know we're traveling on the King's Highway, but sometimes on the King's Highway, you're going to notice some steps, and those steps are a fast track to get you where he needs to get you. But the minute you start complaining, Tony, and you get upset, he'll stop the train. He'll say, go ahead up there and take the scenic route. You got to be willing to go to the subway, to Gethsemane. It's so important to understand this, that God has certain laws and certain principles placed, and he has them for our order. Like the law of gravity. The law of gravity says, what goes up, Elder Walker? It got to come down, but so many people are always focused on what? Going up. Is it no wonder you keep slipping? Is it no wonder you keep saying, I take two steps forward and got to take five steps backwards? Because your mind is always set on going up. But when you go up, you're fighting against the law of gravity. But what God is telling us is, rather than the law of gravity, why don't you try the law of maturity? The law of maturity says what goes down, Dr. Krug, it got to come up. Jesus says, unless a seed is buried in the ground, it ain't gonna have no life out and it won't grow. When you put something down, it will eventually come up. You know, oysters, I don't know if you ever heard this before, but oysters, they undergo affliction. And what brings oysters affliction is whenever a grain of sand gets into the shell of an oyster. When a grain of sand gets into the shell of an oyster, it causes irritation. Say irritation. Some folks are so irritated with everything. And when that sand gets into that shell, that oyster is uncomfortable. Say uncomfortable. And now that oyster has to do something to alleviate the irritation. So what that shell does is it begins to cover that grain of sand with a coat. And it continuously covers this sand with a coat. And a coat. And more of that coat. Now the coat, it never dislodges the sand. My Lord. But what that coat does, Cynthia, is it causes comfort in the midst of irritation. And after that oyster has put enough coat on that sand, when you open up that shell, there's value in mint in what's called a pearl. What I'm here to tell you is God says you're going to get a pearl after this problem. You won't have to go through the irritation. You won't have to go through the frustration. But God says, but I'm going to continue to cover you in the problem. You just got to be willing to stay with it. The first place is Gethsemane, and that represents our lows. But then the next landmark that we have to consider today is Golgotha. Say Golgotha. Golgotha. What Golgotha does is it symbolizes God's love. God's love was put on display on an ugly cross on a hill called Calvary, a place called Golgotha, the place of skulls. God gave us his full measure of love when he gave us Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the ultimate of God's love. It's the zenith. It gets no higher than Jesus Christ. The greatest devastation ever known to man, even if man don't recognize it, the greatest devastation on this earth was Jesus Christ's death. Do you understand? We killed God. It don't get no worse than that. The greatest devastation known to man was Jesus Christ dying for man. But at the same time, it being the greatest devastation, Linda, it was also the greatest demonstration. I'm talking about love illustrated. James, he stretched himself wide. And then he said, nail me to it. I'll take the nailing because I don't plan on getting down. And some people, their love is so conditional. They don't want to be nailed to nothing and no one. But God is fastened to you, my friend. God is nailed to you, beloved. That's the greatest demonstration of God's love is the cross. God showed his love in a profound and a profuse way in that he wanted to die for us. Listen to this. God decided to become a man. I have four children. I love them all. But my love ain't like God's love. I'm trying to get there, y'all. Pray for me. When I consider Omar, Vaughn, Jada, and my youngest Ty, I don't want to be none of them. I love them all. I'm their parent, but I don't want to be them. I'm too busy trying to work out being me than to want to take on their problems. But God loves us so much that he decided to be you. We say Jesus died for you, but more profoundly, Jesus died as you. He didn't just die for us, he died as us. What does that mean? When God looked at Jesus, Harlan, he saw Harlan's face. It's as if Harlan died on that cross. There was a transformation taking place on that. Two was becoming one on that cross. God said, I'm going to become you. I'll die for you. Now I just need to know, are you willing to live for me? I'm talking about God's love. I'm talking about Golgotha. I remember there was a time when I was struggling with my finances one particular year. Seemed like all year long, and Christmas time came. And y'all know the pressure of Christmas. I had a wife and four kids, and all my kids were young at the time. And I was saying, God, I don't have the money for Christmas. And this is no fib. I wouldn't lie to you, at least not in church. And I received a call the day before Christmas. And the call came from my father, my earthly father, Bishop Nate Holcomb. And he called me on the phone and he said, Tyrone, how you doing, son? And I wasn't going to tell him how I was really doing. Whenever Bishop asks you, how you doing? Oh, I'm doing good, Bishop. All is well, sir. How about yourself? I'm over here broke as a joke, busted and disgusted, frustrated. Y'all say hard to get along with. No, I was frustrated and dilated. Y'all women know what that means. I was opening up, man. Stuff was just about to fall out of me, man. And Bishop said, how you doing, son? And I said, oh, I'm doing good, Dad. How about you? He said, I'm doing good. He said, listen, I was just in prayer. He says, and God put you on my heart. And God said that I'm to do something for you. The day before Christmas, I didn't have a gift for my wife or my children. I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to get the money. And Bishop said, hey, come meet me over here. And I met him. And Bishop said, God told me to bless you, son. And I said, oh, thank you, Dad. I'm thinking, oh, Bishop about to lay some money on me. I said, God is good. I said, thank you, Dad. He said, son, listen, man. He said, I'm going to go ahead and give you this. And Bishop pulled out his credit card. I'm looking for cash. But he gave me something better. Amen. See, cash got a limit on it. Somebody better hear what the Lord is saying this morning. We're talking about the God of no limits. You better tap in. Bishop said, take this credit card, Tyrone. And I went and took the credit card. I was fearing and trembling, man. I said, I'm not about to use this credit card. Is Bishop crazy? I can't mess with Bishop's credit card. He said, son, listen to me. Listen to me. He said, it's all right, man. He said, God put you on my heart. And I know it was the Lord because I was just praying to him. He says, and God said to give you that card, son. He says, go and be a blessing to your family. He says, go ahead. He said, don't worry about it, Tyrone. He said, don't worry about it. Go ahead and use the card. I said, well, Dad, your name is on the card. I appreciate all of this, but my name ain't on the card. He said, your name Holcomb, my name Holcomb. He said, your name on that card, son. He said, go ahead, man. He says, as a matter of fact, Tyrone, people always say, you look like me. He said, go ahead and use that card. They're going to think you me anyway. I walked out of there, and I went to the store, and I was shaking. And I gave them the card. They looked at me and asked to see some ID. I said, oh, my God, they want ID. Do you know my first name is Tyrone, his first name is Nathaniel, but they didn't care. All they saw was Holcomb. Bishop said, if you run into any problems, he says, if anybody asks you any questions, if anybody decide to hold out on the goods, you tell them to call me up. I'm here to tell you that God has given you his credit card. When Jesus died on that cross, you got to understand what took place, man. God took the limits off. God gave you his credit card. And not only did he give you his credit card, God gave you his name. And God said, you look just like me. Now walk around and act like it. That's the love of God. That's what Golgotha was all about. God says, I love you just like that. After he left Golgotha, Jesus went to a place called the grave. Say the grave. The thing about the grave, it represents our loss. That's what the grave represents. See, even though you can understand and appreciate God's love for you, sometimes in life, even though you know God loves you, you still take losses. You still experience disappointments. I'm talking to some people right now who got some disappointments, who have unfulfilled expectations, who are looking at dried up desires, whose hope has been deferred. And you've gotten to such a place with your disappointments that you've buried Jesus. The purpose of this grave was to bury Jesus. And some people, even in the house of God, you may be watching me right now. God says, you buried me. When you bury Jesus, you've buried your hope. When you bury Jesus, you're no longer encouraged. You can hear a word like this and it somehow can't get through. I'm praying even right now, Holy Spirit, get through each and every last heart. Some people have buried Jesus. But you got to understand the significance of this grave. When Jesus went in the grave, he took the test for humanity. The test was our sin, and he had to become a perfect sacrifice, Dante. He had to become the perfect sacrifice, Deidre. And he did just that, and he passed the test. I told y'all the last time I was with you how I had issues with statistics. Y'all remember that? But statistics wasn't my only class. I remember just as hard as statistics was, my last class was, is it called Geography with Rocks? I told y'all I struggled. Y'all said it's called what, geology? At least I didn't say geometry, all right? I'm not that bad. Geology was, I thought statistics was hard. Do you know you can be bored to death? Now, we talk about Jesus being the rock of our salvation. But I had to go and take a class to study rocks and minerals. They all was looking alike to me. And I had to study rocks. And man, I had to get into a study group for what? Rocks! And I had to take the final on what? Rocks. Are you kidding me? You want me to, I got rocks everywhere, man. I got rocks in my backyard and my front yard. I got rocks everywhere. And you want me to study rocks and take a test and then a final on rocks. But now here's the point. I'm happy to report to y'all. I didn't get no help on the final. I studied hard and I passed the final. But do you know the evidence of me passing the final was the next semester I wasn't in the seat. If I had failed, I couldn't graduate. If I had failed the next class, I would have been in the seat. But when they came back the next semester, Tyrone was not there. Why? Because I passed. The significance of the tomb is not that his body is in it, it's that his body is gone. His body being gone means he passed the test. God looked at him and all the sins that was on him, your sins, my sins, our sins. And God said, I accept it. It's past. And when you see an empty tomb, not only does it mean God passed the test, but on the cross we see God's love. In the empty tomb, we find his forgiveness. Some people have taken losses in life, one mistake after another, one misstep after another, one misunderstanding after another, one miss after another miss after another miss, and you've given up because you've taken losses. But God wants you to know you've passed. Regardless of what people say, you've passed. Regardless of how others may look at you, you've been forgiven. God wants you to know, don't give up on him because he won't give up on you. A little boy was being pushed in a cart by his mother in the grocery store. And the little boy happened to catch his eye on a box of cookies. And so the boy began to beg his mama, Mama, can I have that box of cookies? And mama said, listen, son, we ain't got time for no box of cookies. Let's go. And the mom went on through the aisle and went down another aisle. And the little boy began to cry. But mama, I want cookie. Mama said, boy, I told you I ain't got time for no cookies. Let's just come on now. She went to another aisle. And the little boy said, but mama, can I have a cookie? She said, boy, I'm telling you, if you keep on bothering me about those cookies, you're going to have a real problem. And the little boy just sat there and his lip was shivering. And the little boy waited until they got to the checkout line. And just when the mama thinks she's about to check out, the little boy stood up in the cart and he yelled out, mama, I want them cookies. And the mama looked around because everybody was in the checkout line. See, she could tell him no in the aisle, but she felt embarrassed about telling him no in the checkout line. What I'm telling you right now, some folks are in the checkout line. You may have checked out on God. You may have checked out on your family. You may be ready to check out at work. Some people, unfortunately, have contemplated checking out on life. But if you're in the checkout line, it's time to stand up and say to God, I want my cookies. And somebody say, oh, wait a minute, Tyrone. You can't embarrass God. You can't put no pressure on God. I'm going to tell you right now, that's what Moses did. When God said, I'm going to take care of Israel, I ain't even going to help Israel. And Moses said, but hold up, God, but they're your people. I don't care about them being my people. Them people are stiff-necked. Moses said, but hold up, God, but it ain't going to be right. I don't care what's right. I decide what's right. Then finally Moses said, okay, God, listen. He said, if you don't help Israel, the surrounding nations, I'm talking about in the checkout line. He said, the people that's looking at you, they're going to say their God couldn't provide. Yes, and all of a sudden God said, let me go get them cookies. Somebody hold my cart. I'm about to go get them cookies. I'm telling you right now, God is going to go get your cookies if you don't check out on him. You just tell God, God, before I quit, I'm going to stand up and say, God, I want my cookies. God said, I'm going to give it to you. Because God will not be embarrassed. God ain't going to let your neighbor look at you and see you going down while they going up. God said, no, I'm going to snap the neck of the sinner. I'm going to make them look at you so quick and say, who in the world? How in the world? And all you got to do is say, my God, my God, my God. He may not have come when I wanted him, but I tell you right now, he came up in the checkout line. This is what happens at the grave, y'all. You might have taken some losses in life, but the tomb is empty. The last landmark I want to talk to y'all about is the garden. It's the garden. We conclude where we began. We opened up Matthew 28. Where? In the garden. In the garden, it represents God's life. Yeah. That's what the garden gives to us, life. But then within God's life, we learn God's lessons. And if you go back to our opening text in Matthew 28 from the garden, the angel was there. They was looking for Jesus. But who they saw was the angel, Siani. They saw the angel. The angel is the messenger. On Palm Sunday, folks say, where is Jesus? The angel said, I'm going to show up. There's going to be some earthquakes going on in your life. There's going to be some shaking taking place. Don't worry about the earthquake right now. Don't worry about the shaking that's going on. The angel sat down. The angel was showing us what to do. What? Sit down. The skill to be still. Just learn to wait. Just learn to be at rest. That's the first lesson that we understand. And then the angel said this while he was sitting, while he was resting. The angel said, you came to see Jesus. But he ain't here. Why are you going to the Christian house of prayer? He ain't there. This is the garden. This is the place where things grow. And he says, Jesus, he ain't here. Listen, he's gone just like he said. So why do we come to the garden? You need to get a word. Right. See, the angel can't tell you just like he said if you ain't never heard what he said. What we have to learn in the garden is that we don't stand on explanations. We stand on the promises of God. Too often, people are so frustrated with the promise because they're waiting on the explanation. But I remember hurting myself in a car accident, and the chiropractor came in the room, and the chiropractor started showing me x-rays. And he started pointing at all this different stuff and talking about this is twisted and this is bent. And I'm going to be honest with y'all, all that foggy stuff on that screen, I can care less about the explanation. Doc, can you fix the problem? And the doctor said, oh, I'm going to fix you. When I left, I didn't leave thinking about the x-rays. I left on his word. I left on his promise. And the angel said, he has risen just like he said he would. You can take God at his word. That's why we come to the garden. That's why we come to the garden for life. There's blood at the garden. There's life in the blood. But then who came? Let me tell you, the Bible says there was two women. One was named Mary of Magdalene. Mary of Magdalene. And the other one was that other Mary. Now, we ain't going to discredit neither Mary. Let me tell you about Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was a woman with a questionable background. But the other Mary was the one who followed without question. You can be either one. I'm going to tell you, I'm of the tribe of Mary Magdalene. I got a questionable background. I don't want to ever become president. I'm telling you the truth. I don't ever want to become president. Tyrone, you don't think you can run the country? I done seen some folk that I know shouldn't have ran this country. And if they can do it, I can do it. But I'm going to tell you why I don't ever want to become president. Not because, come on, Auntie. It ain't because of what we're talking about going on in the future. It's because you're going to vet my past. You're going to start looking too close to my background. And if you look too close to my background, you're going to see some skeletons. Can I be honest with you? You ain't going to see no skeletons. You're going to walk in a cemetery. Come on now. I'm the only one. I understand. I take the hit. I'm the only one. So Mary Magdalene, she came with a questionable background, but then you also had who? That other Mary. Ain't that a blip? That other Mary. Like, she don't matter. Because that other Mary don't seem interesting. That other Mary, she went through life crossing all her T's and dotting all her I's. That other Mary, she follows God, and you don't see nothing wrong with that other Mary. But now he told Mary Magdalene and that other Mary, go back and tell everybody what you've seen today. So I don't care if you're a person with a questionable background or a person who follow with no questions. He says we are all qualified to go back and share the word of God. All this week, our responsibility is to go tell somebody. And if you're real good, you get beyond somebody to some people. And you tell them about how the Lord not only rose in life, but how he changed yours. I remember years ago, it was on 4th of July weekend. Andrea and I went and bought a hotel room in San Antonio, Texas to go visit my son, who was in San Antonio, Texas. And when we got there, much to our surprise, we already had our two daughters, Jada and Todd, with us, staying in the room. So we was going to already be tight with two beds. But then my son said, can I come back to the hotel and stay with y'all for the weekend? I said, wow, we wasn't anticipating that. I said, but come on, we're going to do it. We'll get you a room. Let's do it. He was too big to be staying with us. And so we get back to the hotel, and in the lobby, I'm talking about, it was busy. 4th of July weekend in San Antonio, it was people everywhere. And when we finally got Tracy to the front desk, I said, listen, I have my family with me, and now my son wants to stay this weekend. Can we get another room? And the woman, I mean, it was a guy. The guy said, sir, I'm sorry. We have no more room. He says, it's 4th of July weekend. There's so many events going on. He says, we're full to capacity. And I said, well, I understand. Wow. No problem. I said, well, son, and before I can get it out that he's going to have to just stay in a room with us, we'll make it work. The guy said, hold up, sir. He said, I see here in the computer that you're a gold card member. Now, honestly, I didn't know I was a gold card member. Can I be even more honest? I had to ask him the name because I thought he was talking about my father. And I said nervously, I said, gold card member, I wasn't going to put no room on Bishop's name. I said, oh, if I'm a gold card member, if you don't mind me asking, what name is on there? And he looked down and said, Tyrone Holcomb. I said, wow, I'm a gold card member. So I drew back my shoulders. I said, yeah. So what are we going to do about it? I'm a gold card member. He said, I need to go talk to my supervisor. Wait 1 second. So I went to Andrew. I said, honey, did you know we was gold card members? Andrew, I didn't know. I said, well, they're coming back. So I had the face. You know, I looked real sober. And the supervisor came and said, Mr. Holcomb, we only got one room left. I said, I'll take it. He said, it's the presidential suite. My heart fell inside my size 11s. I said, what in the world? Did he say the presidential suite? And before I can talk, the Holy Spirit says, sit down. Shut up. You ain't got nothing to do with this, Tyrone. Just be quiet. So all I can do is just stand there with a stupid grin on my face. I said, yeah, okay, the presidential suite. And he went to pushing up keys and all of this, and when he got through, he said, there you go. He says, here's your key. Enjoy your stay. I said, well, before I enjoy my stay, how much is it going to cost me? And he said, oh, no, sir. No. There's no additional cost. You a gold card member. I said, okay, now, my original room. I said, I want to be able to tell my wife how this went down. I said, my original room was how much? He said, it was $260. I said, how much is the presidential suite? He said, well, for a night, it's $1,950-something. I said, man, give me my key. As I was walking off all cool towards the elevator, they had a bell hop. I felt like George Jefferson. Now, for y'all young folk, y'all don't know what I'm talking about, but y'all old heads helped me out. I felt like I was moving on up, man. I'm walking on over to the elevator, and as we was getting to the elevator, another bellhop had the unmitigated gall to step out of nowhere and say, now listen, y'all in the presidential suite, make sure y'all don't mess it up. And then Andrea said, he don't know. And I said, no. I said, come on, honey, come on. I'm thinking, this is what I'm thinking. Don't mess up this deal, baby. I said, come on, Dad. She said, no, he don't know what we, I said, listen. I said, honey, you gotta know when you serve the only wise God. I said, we serve the only wise God. And the devil is reduced to making wise cracks. I'm talking about the God that'll get the devil mad. The devil thought he was about to embarrass Tyrone Holcomb, and God gave Tyrone Holcomb the presidential suite. This is what happens in the garden, man. The angel said to Mary, Magdalene, and that other Mary, go tell him. And finally, listen to this. This is where we close. He says, go and tell him. The Lord is not here. And then he says, I'm going to tell you where the Lord went. It's enough to tell me the Lord ain't here. He says, but I'm going to tell you where the Lord went. He says, tell him Jesus went ahead to Galilee. Now, in Galilee, it wasn't a respectable place. Galilee was a location, a region of mixed cultures. Your Orthodox Jew, your traditional Jew, they had no dealings with folks in Galilee. One of the smallest towns in Galilee, you know what that was? Nazareth. And this is why Nathanael, on the day when he was being made a disciple of the Lord, Nathanael said to the other disciple, where'd you say Jesus was from? And he says, Nazareth. He's a Nazarene from Nazareth. And he says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Can anything good come out of Galilee? He says, come on, man, I'm not following nobody from Galilee. And here we find, on the day of the resurrection, the Lord didn't go to the palaces. The Lord wasn't out there hanging at Central Park or Park Avenue. No, the Lord went down to the ghettos. The Lord went to the outcasts. And God says, I'm already ahead of you. So what you waiting for? This week, can you talk to people who don't look like you? This week, can you share the gospel with people who don't like you? The challenge for us during Passion Week is, can you have passion? Don't talk to me about the passion of the Christ if you ain't got passion. Because one thing about the folks at Galilee, they don't play no games. People at Galilee, they done heard it all. People at Galilee, they done been through it all. And they're not asking for us to be perfect. They're just asking for us to have passion. Our life's journey is just like Jesus' passion or his passage of passion. How so? There will be ups and downs. Gethsemane, that's our lows. But Golgotha is God's love. But then the grave, that's our loss. But then finally, the garden, that's where we find God's life and learn God's lessons. This week, focus on Jesus. Walk where he walked and consider carefully every last one of these landmarks. If you would, bow your head. Hallelujah. You can go ahead and give God praise. Go ahead and give God praise. I was just the messenger, that's all. The Holy Spirit is teaching us. This word is to usher us into next Sunday, the Resurrection Sunday. Today is Palm Sunday. Go home and consider these landmarks. And then take these landmarks to the outer landscapes and let people know. We serve a risen King. Amen. Father, we thank you for this word, and we're asking that this word will penetrate the heart of everyone who heard it and those who have yet to hear it. We're asking, God, for the heathen, those that are in Galilee. We ask for the holy and the heathen together. We thank you for the sacred and the secular together. God, we are better together. We vow now, this week, Lord, to go out and to show our passion to a dying world. And now, and I pray if anyone is here under the sound of my voice and they need you, I pray they won't leave without you, without accepting your son, Jesus Christ. It's in Jesus' name I do pray. Amen. Amen. And now I'm going to ask that we bow our heads again. I'm going to give this altar call. This is the Passion Week. During the Passion Week, God is asking for one thing, your heart. Not your head, not your mind. Everything may not make sense in your world right now, my brother. But God says, don't worry about making sense right now. Just come by faith. If you're out there and you're saying, Tyrone, I don't know the Lord. I came here because someone invited me, or I felt a prompting in my soul to come today, and I received this word that you gave. If you're out there and you say, I want to know Jesus, he loves you. He died for you. Today, turn your life around. It's during the altar that I got saved, and I had to ask myself this one question, and I'm asking you to ask yourself that this morning. That question is simply this: is your way working? You've been trying to do it on your own. How's that working out for you? Do you have peace? If your way isn't working, then stop doing it your way. Today is the day that you can go God's way. I want to just pray for you. I'm not going to embarrass you. I promise you that. All over the sanctuary, just raise your hand up high if you want to receive Jesus. God bless you, my sister. Don't be afraid. Raise your hand up. This is your moment. All over the sanctuary, I see you. All over the sanctuary, all the way in the back. More importantly, God sees you. This is so important. Don't get dressed up. Put clothes on. Come all the way this way just to say no to God. Humble yourself and admit, my way is not working. I want to try it God's way. If that's you, one more time, you want to know Jesus, raise your hand up right now. Remember, the angel said, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. God bless you, my sisters. God is going to help you. Listen to me. God is going to help you. Stand on that word. The word you heard, remember the angel said he did it just as he said he would. You can be out there and you can say, Tyrone, I know God. I know I've been following him, but I'm going to be honest with you. I have not been following him closely lately. I've allowed the earthquakes, the shaking going on in my life. I've allowed the distractions to pull me from the main attraction, God. In other words, you're a backslider. You know what that means. You've been following God. And if that's you, today is your day. You could have been in an argument with your spouse. You could have got upset with your parent. Whatever the situation is, don't worry about that. Know that the angel, this messenger this day, is talking to you, telling you it's your time. Come back, my sister. That's right. You're looking at me. I'm going to talk directly to you. Come back. If you don't know him, come back if you know him, my brother, but you want to get close again. If that's you all over the sanctuary, say, pray for me, Tyrone. I want to come back to God. Raise your hand. Nobody's going to force you. You got to want him. You got to want him. That's it. That's it. That's it. Give God your heart. Listen. This is Passion Week. If you can't give God your heart, you know you're going to find it hard giving people your heart. Your heart has been hurt. God says, give it back to Him. He wants to heal it this morning. Finally, you may be out there and you say, Brother Holcomb, I need a church while I'm in this area. I sense the love of God in this place. The people are so inviting. Listen, we're not perfect. We never claim to be perfect. We all have problems. We all have issues that we're overcoming. But in this place, we recognize the perfect God. The Lord has a perfect love. And you need to have a place where you can learn more about the love of God. The world is beating you up out there. You need a church home that you can come with other believers. And you've already contemplated this before you came. And now, this is your opportunity. No matter your age, you could be young, you could be older. But if you need a church home, this is your time. While you're here in this area, come fellowship with us. If that's you, raise your hand. I want to pray for you all over the sanctuary. God bless you. Your answered prayer. We're praying for you. God bless you. God bless you. God sees you. God sees you. Now listen to me, beloved. I'm going to have us all stand up now. And if you raised your hand for any one of those appeals to know Jesus, to ask Jesus to come into your life, to get close to God again, backsliding, or to become a member of this church, the Christian House of Prayer, and fellowship with us, we welcome you. Come down now. Come down now. Chop, let's stand up. Give them praise as they're coming down. And listen, some of you, you wanted to raise your hand, and you didn't, but come down now. Some of you raised your hand, but now you don't want to come down. You got to come down. We're not going to embarrass you. This is your hour. This is your time. Let's praise God for them, Chop. Come on down. It's time. It's time. It's time. God bless you. Come on. God sees you. Come on. Come on down. Come on down. It's time. Now listen. Listen. I don't play around with the altar call. I don't. I don't count heads and I don't take numbers. But I know that you're still out there. This is what some people do because I did it. Well, I'm waiting for you to say a special thing. And if you say a special thing, I know you're talking to me. We're not going to play with God this morning. God is telling you like He told them. It's your time. But it has to be a salvation that you want. Listen to me now. If you can admit your way has not been working, if you can admit I don't have the peace that I desire in my life, then God is talking to you. I'm not going to give another altar call after this one. I'm just going to start praying. But I'm going to pray right now, Holy Spirit, there's at least 15 people still out there. Give them strength. Give them strength to trust you, to trust you, to trust you. I thank you even right now, Holy Spirit. And now, listen, Christian House of Prayer. I'm going to give this altar call, but I want you to let your neighbor know, I'll go with you. That's all. Just tell them, I'll go with you. It's time. The 15 people who God is talking to, come down now. This is it. I'm about to pray. Look at your neighbor and tell him, I'll go with you. Don't be afraid. It starts the passion now. Tell him, I'll go with you. I'll go with you. But this is the time. Let's praise God. I'm about to pray. It's time for you to come down. It's time to come down now. Hallelujah. I'm about to pray. They're coming. Come on, saints. They're coming. Praise God. They're still coming. This is the time. Don't let this hour go. This is what's going to happen. You're going to go home and you're going to say, I should have went down. The Holy Spirit is going to strengthen you. That's right. The Holy Spirit is strengthening you. Turn your back on the devil right now. You are a gold card member. It's time for you to act like it. Come down now. He's giving you the presidential suite. You gotta come and take it. Come down now. Come on down. They still coming, Chop. They still coming. It don't matter what your title is. It don't matter how long you've been in the church. This is Palm Sunday. Hosanna! 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 That means save, Lord, now. Say Hosanna, saints. Hosanna! Say Hosanna, saints. Hosanna! Say Hosanna, saints. Hosanna! That means save, Lord, now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And now I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray like I said I would. My sister, if you coming, you can come on down. There's still room for you. Covering that precious baby. God, praise God. You can still come down here. Some of y'all need to do like they do on The Price is Right. He say, come on down. And folks be running down there for a car or a dishwasher. I'm telling you, God gonna give you something better than a dishwasher. God is talking about your life. It's time to come on down. Hallelujah. They still coming. They still coming. They still, not only are they still coming, there's those that still want to come. But I'm about to pray. I'm not going to give the invite again. Now when I start praying, if you know you're supposed to be down here, just start praying while you're walking down that aisle. Come get yours. I'm asking everybody who is standing down here to raise up your hands. When you lift up your hands, this is our way of indicating to God, God, I'm surrendering to you. God, my way has not been working, and I'm asking for your way. And I'm going to say a simple prayer for you. They still coming. Say, God, I'm going to just say a simple prayer. And as I say this prayer, and you know they still coming. You know you're supposed to come on down. Just say the prayer while you coming down. It ain't too late. You just got to believe God. Look at them. They still coming. You got to. Listen, I hear the Holy Spirit. I hear the Holy Spirit. They ain't still coming, only they still want to come. And I'm telling you, I'm about to pray. Now I need you all, while your hands is up, just say this simple prayer. Dear God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sacrificing your son for me. Thank you for forgiving me. I stand here today like Mary Magdalene with a questionable background. But God, you still love me. Thank you. I believe in my heart. I confess with my mouth. Your son, Jesus Christ, died for me. Rose again so that I may be saved. For that, I say thank you. And now, because he died for me, I want to live for him. I want to serve him in a church like this. Help me, Lord, in my life to get past hurts. Help me, Lord, in my life where I've given up hope. Help me, Lord. Hosanna. 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 Save now, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. And now, God, I thank you for every last one of them who responded to this altar call. I thank you, God, that you would seal them with your Holy Spirit. You would mark them as your very own. And now every demon, when they see these, they'll know they belong to you. These are your gold card members. And I thank you, God, for elevating them and touching them in such a way that they're going to touch their families, they're going to touch their communities. In Jesus' name, amen. Give God glory. If you're standing here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and your Savior, but you came down to receive Jesus for the first time, can you indicate that by just raising your hand if you came down to get Jesus in your life? Is there anyone? Hallelujah. Praise God, I thank you for these two. Thank you, Mother, for bringing them down. Get them early. Thank you. Thank you for raising them up to come to the house of God. Now, one more question. If you're down here and you want to know more about this church while you're in this area, and you came down to know more about this church and to become a member, you're already a gold card member in the family of God, but if you want to come fellowship with us here, can you raise your hand so we can count you, starting over here? God bless you, my brother. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. God bless you, my sister. 9, 10. God bless you. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Hallelujah, hallelujah. For those of you, we're about to dismiss. For those of you, your answered prayer, my brothers, my sisters, that's joining in with us. Well, I told you before, we're not a perfect people. We don't claim to be, but we serve a perfect God with a perfect love. We thank you for trusting our pastor, Pastor Valerie, the elderships, the deaconships here, and the memberships. We thank you for trusting us to love on you and grow together in God. If you want to become a member of the Christian House of Prayer, do we have anybody? This gentleman right here in the center, I need you real quick. He's just going to take some quick information from you. I promise you, they won't keep you long. Go ahead and do an about face and go towards the center. We want to get some information and we want to pray for you. Let's praise God for him. We won't keep you long. We won't keep you long. Let's praise God for our new members, Christian House of Prayer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They're all the way over here. Praise God. Hallelujah. Make sure they don't get lost. They walking fast up there. Make sure they don't get lost, William. Praise God. Let's praise God once again for our new members. Amen. We always want to make sure that we give our woman of God. You good? Amen. Thank you, Pastor Valerie. Let's praise God once again for the lead sheep of this house, Pastor Valerie Holcomb. Hallelujah. Thank God. We love you, Pastor Valerie. We love you. Christian House of Prayer, y'all already know what it is. We better together. We love each other. We love God. We love ourselves. We love everybody else. So why don't you act like it when you leave here? Amen. Hug on somebody, love on somebody. We dismiss. God bless. Have a wonderful, wonderful Passion Week. Will and see you all Resurrection Sunday. Bring somebody back with you Resurrection Sunday.